welcome to my teaching ministry, A Heart After God Bible Teaching Ministry. Now, this ministry is designed to teach God's Word in depth with the greatest possible reverence for Him and for His Word, and with a prayerful and earnest desire to build you up greatly through His Word and by the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, this is my first broadcast, and I'll be going through as many of the parables of Jesus as I can. Hopefully, and Lord willing, I'll be able to teach through all of them. Now, I want to say that my audience is for everyone, so please share the link with as many people as you can, especially if they're interested in learning about the parables of Jesus. But I do also have a primary audience, and that is the pastors and the church leaders that I love in Siaya, Kenya. These are men and women who are so hungry for biblical and pastoral training. But let me emphasize again, this teaching is for everyone, but I'm particularly taking advantage of the technology that we have to speak to those pastors and leaders in Kenya. And I'm sure that if you're not part of those people in Kenya, you can appreciate my approach. And I'll tell you that you'll also benefit greatly, whoever you are and wherever you are. Now, at this point, I do want to give my greetings to the men and women in Siaya, Kenya, in their language, which is Luo, and say to you all, Amoso Osiepena Magenu, Misawa Ahinya, and Opak Roth, and Opaki Yesu. And if you're speaking Swahili, Bwana Sifiwe. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Well, loved ones, before we actually come to our first parable of Jesus, and that'll be the parable of the sower, I need to take a good amount of time with an introduction to those parables and explain the background, explain principles of Bible study. So I want to say at the outset, it's going to be a little bit technical at first before we get into the text. Please be patient with me. Those technical things that I explain, they are going to help you greatly improve your Bible study. And so you've got the notes for those. But in the explanation, just be patient and know that as you learn these principles, again, that's going to help you to interpret the parables and indeed all of the Bible much, much better. And so that leads me right away to the notes in paragraph number one. And that is that I'm teaching this study and I've written the notes for you for a number of reasons. First, I deeply love God's Word. And I want His people to know it well and to be able to understand it and interpret it accurately. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15. I'm going to give you a little bit of time to get there. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15. Paul writes to Timothy, a young pastor that he had put in charge of the church in Ephesus. And he says these words, be diligent, that is, make every effort to present yourself approved to God. That Greek word approved means to approve after testing. And that's one of the things that preachers and teachers of God's Word are going to face all the time. We're constantly being tested by God so that He can approve us to continue to teach His Word. So Paul says to Timothy, be diligent, make every effort to present yourself approved to God as a workman who does not need to be ashamed, accurately handling, and notice what he says, the word of truth. That's my goal. That's where my heart is at. Well, that brings me to number two in the notes. The second reason that I'm teaching on the parables of Jesus is because there's a fear among Christians to read the parables, let alone to accurately interpret the parables. Christians are afraid that they will misunderstand the parables. And I know that some preachers and teachers are reluctant to teach on the parables for that reason. Well, we want to change that for good reasons. Now, there's a third reason that I'm teaching the parables of Jesus, and that's because, paragraph number three in your notes, and that's because roughly one-third in your notes, one-third of Jesus' teaching consists of parables. Now, that is a remarkable amount of all of his teaching in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, which is called the Synoptic Gospels, because of the Greek word means a seeing together. There's so much similarity in the three Gospels. However, Matthew was written primarily to a Jewish audience. Mark was Peter's ministerial companion, and Mark really wrote his Gospel through Peter's influence. But Mark writes primarily to Romans. Romans have a short attention span. They're interested in action and power. And that's why the Gospel of Mark says, you find the Gospel of Mark over and over and over saying, immediately this, immediately that, immediately he went here, immediately he did this. Whereas Matthew is much longer, of course, right? Matthew has 28 chapters, Mark only has 16 chapters. And Matthew writes to people of the book. The Jews were and are people of the book. And Matthew has a tremendous amount of focus on prophecy and fulfillment because he wants to show his Jewish readers that Jesus is the fulfillment of all the prophets. Now, Luke is entirely different from Matthew and Mark in that Luke is a Gentile. In fact, isn't it amazing that Luke is the only Gentile author in the entire Bible? Of all the 40 men who wrote in the Bible or wrote books that ended up in our Bible, only Luke he's the only Gentile, and he's writing primarily for a Greek audience. So he has things that he wants to focus on for a non-Jewish audience. You find a huge amount of parables that are about Jesus that are unique to Luke. For example, the parable of the three parables of the lost coin, the lost sheep, and the prodigal son. That is unique only to Luke. And the parable in Luke chapter 10, I forget it right offhand, the Good Samaritan. That's only in Luke. You won't find that in Mark or Matthew. So we're going to talk about more about the background of the parables shortly. But I say all that to say that that's a lot of the entire amount of the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. One-third of all of Jesus' teaching are in parables. No wonder we're studying the parables of Jesus. And so in your notes, paragraph number four, it's also for these reasons that my concern as a pastor and teacher in the body of Christ is that Jesus' followers know him and understand and live out his teaching. And that leads me to paragraph number five. Hence, this effort on my part will be to carefully and accurately explain those parables by exegeting them in their historical, cultural, and literary context. I said I was going to get into some technical aspects before we get to the parables. I just did. But I'm going to come back to those three words over and over and over again. Historical, cultural, and literary context of the Word of God. If we don't keep in mind the historical context of the Word of God, the cultural context of the Word of God, and its literary context, that is, the verses that come before what we're reading and the verses that come after, and the context of the book that it appears in the Bible, and the context of the entire Bible. Those things are absolutely vital to continually keep in mind as we study the Word of God and as we teach the Word of God. Now, I just mentioned a moment ago, I mentioned a word exegeting. Now, that's probably not a word that you're very familiar with, so let me explain it. The word to exegete, paragraph number 6 in your notes, to exegete a passage of Scripture, and it comes from the Greek word exegeomai, or exago, which means to lead out. That blank in paragraph number 6 means to lead out of the text, to lead out of this text in an accurate way. It can also mean to lift out and explain the meaning of that text in its original intent and purpose. Its original intent and purpose, which leads me to paragraph number 7. The careful expositor does this by doing all that he or she can to understand the historical context in which what he is studying or teaching on was written or spoken. Now, paragraph number 8 in your notes, an expositor is a teacher of God's word who teaches through either a book of the Bible or at least a passage of the Bible. So I'm an expositor with you teaching the parable of the sower in Mark chapter 4. So I'm bringing out the parable of the sower in Mark chapter 4, but in order to bring it out accurately, I have to understand the historical context in which Jesus taught it. I also have to understand the cultural context. These were Jews. They were not 21st century Americans. They were not 21st century Kenyans. That society is 2,000 years removed from us. So we have to understand something about that society. And then the literary context is what's written, that is, in the Bible. You've heard people say that it's so easy to take a verse out of its context and make it mean whatever you want it to mean, right? And for my brothers and sisters in Kenya, we've talked about that extensively, haven't we? That you're familiar with preachers and apostles and prophets who take one word or one verse and preach on it for an hour or two, and it has no accuracy from its original text, so they make it to be whatever they want it to be. And I know that is not your heart, and that's certainly not my heart, and it is not God's heart for us to do that. So like any book that we read, if you read a biography, you have to know something. If I'm reading a biography on Winston Churchill, for example, the great English prime minister, in order to understand Winston Churchill, I have to go back in time, not to American culture, but to British culture, back into the early 1900s, all the way up through the 1940s, World War II. That's the historical context. I also have to understand something of the cultural context of the time in which Churchill lived. And then the literary context would be more along the lines of, it would be the book itself. So if I just read of his childhood and I say, well, that's the story of Winston Churchill, you could easily say, no, you're wrong. That's a part of the story of Winston Churchill, but it's not the whole story of Winston Churchill. Conversely, if I just focus on the years that he was Prime Minister of Great Britain in World War II, and I understand, and I try to understand the totality of his life just from those war years, I'm not going to get the entire picture of who Winston Churchill really is, right? That's reasonable. Well, it's no different than the Word of God. Even though the Word of God is like no other book in the history of the world, it's still written, and it has a context. I think I've made my point well, and that helps me to go to paragraph number 9. Now, as you're turning to paragraph number 9, please turn with me to John chapter 1. I want to give you another example of what it means to exegete the Word of God, to lift out and give us the proper understanding. John chapter 1 And verse 18 says this: "No one has seen God at any time. The only begotten God," or the Greek word begotten means the only unique one of its kind, "the only begotten God who is in the bosom of the Father." John is using a language to show us the absolute intimacy between the Father and the Son. "The only begotten God," the only unique God, notice he's referring to Jesus as God, "who is in the bosom of the Father, he has explained him." The Greek word is where we get exegesis from. It means to draw out or to lift out, to explain. Now, Jesus is explaining the totality of who the Father is. That's what the entire Gospels are all about. He doesn't just give us one insight on the Father. He comes to show us the Father and explain the Father through and through. That's what our job is when we study God's Word and when we teach God's Word. So in paragraph number 9 of your notes, I write, "A good biblical example of this critically important task and discipline," and it is a spiritual discipline, "can be seen in John 1:18 with the word translated 'explained.'" And I've just explained that to us. Now, the other thing, I've alluded to this just shortly ago, but let's remind ourselves when we're studying God's Word and preaching and teaching God's Word, we are thousands of years removed from the historical context of the Old Testament, 3,000 years, and we're 2,000 years removed from the New Testament. You don't speak Greek fluently. I don't speak Greek fluently. You don't speak Hebrew fluently, which is what the Old Testament is written in. I don't speak Hebrew fluently. So we have to define words as well. So to dig into the past is one of the three critically important tasks for any interpreter of Scripture. What are those three things? Historical context, cultural context, and literary context. If I want to understand Kenyans, I have to understand the history of your nation, right? If I want to understand Kenyans, I have to learn something about the culture. If I want to really understand Kenyans, and particularly those of the Luo tribe, it might be a good idea to actually visit the Luo tribe in your area of Kenya and get to know you and learn the language and all that. Again, those are reasonable things. That's how we approach Scripture. And loved ones, I guarantee you this, that if we develop those three things, we are going to be much better students of Scripture. We're going to get more out of God's Word. And I know you want to get more out of God's Word. And when we preach and teach, we are going to do a much better job for our Lord, for His honor, for His glory, of teaching His Word to His people. By the way, I want to share something else with you just a moment. Just for a moment, I'm going to sidetrack just for a second. I was reading John 7 this morning, and I was really struck by what Jesus said to the Jewish religious leaders. He said in John 7, let me find it. John 7, verse 16, Jesus says this: "My teaching is not mine, but His who sent me." My teaching. Notice how God the Son submits to God the Father. "My teaching is not mine, but His who sent me." And then, if you'll notice with me in verse 18, "He who speaks from himself seeks his own glory. But he who is seeking the glory of the one who sent him, he is true, and there is no unrighteousness in him." Loved ones, we can learn some powerful principles of us teaching God's Word when we understand and accept the fact that what we teach and what we preach is not ours. We are stewards of God's Word. We don't own God's Word. God's Word owns us. Amen? His Word owns us. I am just a steward of God's word. And what I teach is not mine. It does not belong to me. It belongs to our triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen? Well, that has nothing to do specifically with the parables, but it has everything to do with our teaching ministry. Now, let's go back to the notes. And it's going to take me just a second to get back to those notes. Bear with me. Paragraph number 11 in your notes. By understanding the historical context of the Bible, we are less likely to misinterpret or to misapply its teachings. I know you don't want to misinterpret Scripture. And I know that you don't want to incorrectly apply its teachings. That's what this course, this study is all about, that we will teach, that we will accurately interpret God's word and then accurately teach it as well. Let me just say this. Our people, God's people, that he entrusts to us, they're not our people. They're not your people. They belong to Jesus Christ. We are just under shepherds who seek to build the church of God and see his people thrive. And so they deserve the best, don't they? Do they? They deserve the best. And when we're walking in our best, the world sees God's best as well. Isn't that right? Amen. Hallelujah. So when people don't interpret Scripture correctly, they routinely misinterpret and incorrectly apply the Word of God in general and the parables in particular. So, Coro. I've already explained a number of things. Let me move on to paragraph number 12. And you know this very painfully, and I do too. When people misinterpret Scripture and misapply it and don't interpret it in its historical, cultural, and literary context, that is where heresies, cults, and false religions and movements get their start. That's paragraph number 12 of your notes. This is where so many heresies, cults, and false religions and movements get their start. A heresy is a twisting of what's right. That is orthodox Christianity. Straight, the Greek word orthodox means straight and accurate. A heresy means to teach something other than what is accurate. And you see that and you experience that in your culture all the time, and I do as well. That leads me to paragraph number 13. We know this, but it's good to be reminded of it. Scripture was not initially written to you or to me, but the supernatural aspect an origin of Scripture is that it still speaks to us, and profoundly, it's God speaking to me and God speaking to you, even though this was written to a different culture and in a different time. That's the amazing thing about Scripture. It was written to Jews and Gentiles. Again, 3,000 years ago in the Old Testament, 2,000 years ago in the New Testament. And different situations called for what was written then. Paragraph 14. To know those situations, loved ones, that helps us vastly to appreciate and accurately interpret and apply that word to our situation. And that is the miracle of the inspired Word of God. You know, I realized that I jumped into this teaching and I never even stopped to pray. I never, ever, ever teach without first praying. But I think I was so concerned about greeting my brothers and sisters in CIA, I just completely forgot. But that's okay. Let's stop and pray right now. And as you say in Luo, Walem, Walem. So let's pray. We pray to Nyesai. Nyesai Bear, God is good. Heavenly Father, we ask now that you would anoint us to understand your word, that you would prepare our hearts to understand the importance of laying a great foundation in Bible study and interpretation, so that we can be better students of your word and better teachers of your word as well. So we invite you, Holy Spirit, be Roho Maler. Be Roho Maler. Come, Holy Spirit, and teach us and guide us and change us and transform us so that we can all daily become more like you, Lord Jesus, because we ask it in your name. Amen and amen. Well, let's move on. I'm in paragraph number 15 of your notes. The same can be said of the culture of the Bible. Now, in some ways, their culture is vastly different from ours, but in some ways, our cultures are similar. Why? Because, well, we're all human beings, but also because so much of our own culture is actually rooted in biblical times, more than we realize. Paragraph 16, finally, to interpret Scripture carefully, wisely, and accurately, we must heed rules of interpretation within its literary context. And that leads me to paragraph 17. In the general sense, and I've mentioned this before, but I'm going to mention it again, by literary, we mean the use and meaning of the language of the Bible and how, now watch this, how each verse fits in with the passage that it comes from, as well as the overall chapters and the book or letter itself. Just a thought off the top of my head, when Jesus says, I am the good shepherd, what that ought to remind us of is what? I hope that you're thinking Psalm 23, right? The Lord, and the word for Lord there is Yahweh. Yahweh is my shepherd. When Jesus says, I am the good shepherd, he is making a direct claim to deity. He is saying that he is equal to the Father, even though he's a human being, right? Even though he's a man. And that reminds us, that should remind us that Jesus, the historical Christian faith, has held to this reality, this fact that Jesus is one person with two natures, perfectly God and perfectly man, and perfectly united, but not mixed. That's why, for example, when Jesus died on the cross, he shed human blood, and he died a literal death, and he was raised literally, so that he could say to his disciples, particularly Thomas, look at my hands and put your hand into my side, so that you can know I am not a spirit, but I have flesh and bones as you see that I have. And yet he is perfect God. So that even though in his humanity he said that no one knows the day or the hour of his return, not the Father, not the angels, not anyone else, not even the Son of Man. But in his deity, he certainly knows when he's going to return. But what did Jesus do in the incarnation? Paul tells us in Philippians 2, verses 5 through 9, that he laid aside not his deity. He did not lay aside his deity. He laid aside, the Greek word there means to lay aside his privileges as God, and he humbled himself by taking upon himself flesh and becoming a bondservant of Jesus Christ. He didn't grasp at his authority as God to do what he did. He depended upon the Father so that we could relate to him. If you're God, you can't cease being God. But on the cross, God didn't die because it's impossible for God to die. I hope you understand that. One person with two natures, perfect God, perfect man, sinless man, perfectly united but not mixed. The human nature is not mixed with the divine nature, and I just gave you reasons for that. Well, I've gotten away from the notes, but that's an important thing to talk about anyway. That leads me to paragraph number 18 in your notes. The Old Testament, and in your notes hereafter, I'm abbreviating it as OT. The Old Testament was written in Hebrew, quite a different language than the one I'm writing in. And thus, defining Hebrew words is going to be extremely helpful in us getting the most out of that language. But, well, let me move on to paragraph number 19. The same holds true for the New Testament, which hereafter I'm abbreviating as NT. It was written in Greek, which has a diversity of meanings different than English words. But actually, many English words have their roots in the Greek language. Very interesting. So because the New Testament is written in Greek, naturally we're going to define, most of the words that we define are going to be out of the New Testament in Greek. But occasionally, I'm going to show the origin of those parables in the Old Testament as well, and therefore I'll define Hebrew words. You'll be grateful that I do. Paragraph 20. When these words are defined and explained for us, loved ones, we glean a much greater understanding of the text that we're studying. Now, the literary context, more specifically, has to do with the verse that comes before the verse that we're reading and after the particular verse that we're reading, so that we don't take one context, one verse out of its context and attempt to make it say what we want it to say. One heretical teaching, and one of these days I'm going to do an in-depth teaching on the accurate interpretation of water baptism. Water baptism is very important to Jesus Christ. He commanded every believer to be baptized in water, right? Now, there are certain heretical teachings that say if you've not been baptized, you're not saved. Now, that is not a biblical teaching. Is it important to be baptized? Yes, it's important to be baptized. But if to say that because you haven't been baptized, you're not born again, that is completely eliminating the way that we get saved. And Paul tells us in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, for by grace are you saved through faith. By grace are you saved through faith. And let me read it. It's a memory verse for me, and for some reason I'm struggling to remember it. That's what happens when you get to be 56 years old. So Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. I was on the right track. And that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not works, lest any man should boast. The minute I ask Jesus to be my Lord and Savior, the minute I repent of my sins, I am born again. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. It's after that that I need to obey the Lord in baptism. But the teachers who err in this doctrine, this important doctrine, essential doctrine, will take one verse out of context in Acts chapter 2, verse 38. Peter said to them, repent, and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, when I read it in English, and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, that sounds, doesn't it, like I have to be baptized to receive forgiveness of sins. But there's a context. there's the context of Acts chapter 2, and then there's the context of the entire New Testament. And so, and moreover, the Greek word for, he says, let each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. The Greek word henna can mean due to or because of. And it probably should be translated because of the forgiveness of your sins. Because baptism can't save us. Baptism, the water can't even cleanse us. It is a symbol to show us our union with Jesus Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection. It's extremely important to keep that in mind. That's as far as I can go with that teaching right now. But it is on my heart because I wonder in your churches, men and women, have all of your people been baptized in water? And do they understand that baptism doesn't save them and that the water doesn't cleanse their sins? It's the blood of Jesus that cleanses us from our sins, and it's calling on his name that saves us from our sins. We'll get into that more at another time. Now, paragraph number 22 in your notes. Moreover, the literary context means that we go even deeper. I know that's what you want to do. We need to develop the discipline of looking at the entire passage before the particular verse we're studying or trying to understand, and we must examine the passage that follows. Okay? We'll get into that more at length. Again, let me just say this. I know that this is technical. I understand that. I know you probably want to just jump right in to the parable of the sower. I know that. I appreciate that. I'm like that as well. But remember, we all want to become better students of Scripture. And I can guarantee you that because I was taught this in seminary, my skills in studying the Bible just skyrocketed. And I'm still benefiting from that training. So be patient with me, please. Let's go to paragraph number 23. Everything in Bible study has a context. It's literary, cultural, and historical context. And the reverent interpreter, the one who truly fears God, will always seek to keep these things in mind. Remember we studied 2 Timothy 2, verse 15, where Paul said, be diligent to present yourself approved to God as a workman who does not need to be ashamed, accurately handling the word of truth. Now, let's go to paragraph number 24. In addition, we have a wide range of different writings in the Bible. Some of the writings are historical. For example, 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel and Kings and Chronicles. Some are narrative. There's a lot of narrative stories being told in those books, for example. Some of the Bible is songs, the things that we sing, and they're also called poetry. What am I referring to? The Book of Psalms. We have 150 songs, S-O-N-G-S, that we sing, but because it's written in the Bible, we often forget that they are originally songs and they're Hebrew poetry. So we interpret it differently than we do historical context. And then some of what we read in Scripture is instructional, like the Paul's epistles, for example, and Peter's epistles. Revelation, paragraph number 25 in your notes. Revelation is apocalyptic literature. It means it has to be unveiled. It's something that involves a lot of symbols, but it's also prophetic literature. John actually calls it a prophecy. So these things are substantially different than anything else in God's Word. And then again, for our purposes, parables are altogether different than the other writings. And so many people want to interpret parables as if they're allegories. They are not allegories. An allegory is something that has a hidden meaning that only the Holy Spirit can bring out. And there are very, very few allegories anywhere in Scripture. There's an allegory of Isaac and Ishmael. I mean, it's Isaac and Ishmael, the story of Isaac and Ishmael are historical. They're real. But the Holy Spirit showed the Apostle Paul in Galatians chapter 4 that there are allegorical meanings. But think about this. You and I are not qualified to write Scripture. God set apart Paul to write Scripture. The Holy Spirit showed him an allegory. But for us, and Paul actually says this is allegorically speaking, but for us to have the arrogance to come to the Word of God, particularly parables, and say, the Holy Spirit showed me hidden meanings. No, He did not. There's enough right there in the parable, which a parable is simply an illustration or a comparison, a story that compares certain truths. And a parable usually is focused on one or two main points. All that information is in your notes. But for us to come up with allegorical hidden meanings in parables is a very dangerous thing to do, and it's unbiblical. We'll focus on that much more, but I think it's good for me to get ahead of myself now. Listen, paragraph number 6, beloved. Paragraph number 26, I'm sorry. The role of the interpreter is to pay extremely careful attention to detail with the literary context and not read into the passage something that is not there. Please keep that in mind. Likewise, paragraph 27, the interpreter must not insert his opinions when explaining the text. Unless a text is so difficult, with many interpretations from many commentators over the centuries, that as a last resort, he offers his opinion, rather than dogmatically asserting that his opinion is right and it's the only opinion. Rarely do I offer opinions when I'm teaching through the Word of God. The only time that I offer an opinion is in an area of Scripture that is difficult to understand. And even then, I will say, as I've been diligent to study Scripture, and as I've been diligent to do my homework, to examine everything, this is how I see it. But I want to tell you something, that this is my opinion, and that's it. It's my opinion, no more. You say, well, but Paul said in Corinthians, he said, the Lord said this, not I, and I say this, not the Lord. That's an interpretation issue, and the reality, the accuracy of that, Paul is referring to statements that Jesus made about divorce, and he's referring to statements that Jesus did not make. And when Paul says, I say not the Lord, he's not saying that he's not inspired by the Holy Spirit. All he's simply saying to the Corinthians is that Jesus didn't say anything about that particular situation. Now, Paul is addressing it, but he's still addressing it by the authority of the Holy Spirit. Well, there are so many things to teach in the Word of God, and we just can't do it all at once, can we? Well, let's move on to paragraph number 28. Moreover, there is already resident within the text itself so much to observe. We don't need to strain to come up with something new. The Lord showed me, I got a revelation. We don't need to do that. There is enough already that's challenging to understand in the Word of God that we could teach forever and still not come to the end of it. You don't need, and I don't need, to come up with something new to set me apart from all the other preachers and teachers. The preachers and teachers of God's Word that are the greatest are the ones that are most faithful to Scripture. Hallelujah. Amen. What a powerful statement that is. Let me say it again. The greatest preachers and teachers of God's Word in the world are those who are faithful to teach what the Word of God says and not to try to come up with something on their own. Amen? That's a powerful statement. Now, paragraph number 29, instead, let us carefully and patiently partner with our teacher, the Holy Spirit, to make those observations and those time-honored applications. Paragraph 30, furthermore, let us also submit ourselves in humility and in the fear of the Lord to the time-honored interpretations of the church in general, respecting the fact that interpreters have worked through every single verse that we're examining. They've been doing that for thousands of years now. Accordingly, paragraph 31, we must have the humility and the wisdom to carefully consider commentary from the study Bibles that we have. That's why Pastor Daniel and I were so committed to getting you all those study Bibles because of the excellent commentary below the text of the Bible itself. So there's wisdom in that. And we should carefully consider those commentary notes from the study Bibles that we have, the commentaries that we invest in, and my heart is to get you commentaries, and the wise counsel of men and women who have a proven track record of sound interpretation. Loved ones, paragraph 32, if we reject these things, we are already moving in pride, and we will soon have God Himself resisting us. Open your Bibles with me to 1 Peter chapter 1, chapter 5. You say, are we ever going to get to the parables? Yes, we are. Please hang in there with me. 1 Peter chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 5, beginning in verse 5. Peter writes, you younger men, likewise, be subject to your elders, and all of you, the whole church, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another. How are you doing with that right now? Are you clothing yourself in humility toward one another? All of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, for, here's the reason or purpose, God is opposed to the proud, but gives grace to the humble. When we move in pride, God sticks His hand up with us, and He stops us. When we move in humility, He opens His hand to us, and He says, come, let me bless you. Isn't that powerful? We move in pride, God says, I resist you. We move in humility, God says, come, I help you. Which would you rather have? Amen? So he says, Peter says in verse 6, therefore humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time. What does that say about the nature of our God? He wants to lift us up. He wants to exalt us. That's incredible. But God says that if we're moving in pride, He cannot lift us up. He cannot exalt us. So what does He say? Therefore, humble yourselves, verse 6, under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you at the proper time. And there it is right there. Well, let's move on to paragraph number 33. What is most important of all is what we do with what we've observed. Are we obeying Jesus' teaching, right? Paragraph 34, all of this serves to explain my approach in helping you to draw closer to our Lord through His Word, to know that you're handling it accurately and applying it carefully. And that leads me to paragraph 35. This is my responsibility to you. I take that responsibility extremely seriously because I know that I'm handling the Word of God, not the word of man. This is the Word of God. It is not the word of man. There's only one Word of God, and that's this. As such, God is going to hold me accountable with how I interpret and with what I teach to you and to everybody else. Paragraph 36, I mentioned that about my style. Let me just jump past that. But read 36, read paragraph 37, read paragraph 38, read paragraph 39, read paragraph 40. In fact, it would be good if you can pause the video and read through those paragraphs that I'm skipping through. Don't pause it yet. Read through paragraph 41. So read through all those paragraphs. Read those paragraphs that I just mentioned. And why don't you go ahead and pause that now? Pause the video now and read through them. And then when you're done, then let's continue on in the video. Okay? You go do that now. Very good. All right, now that you're back, let me just read paragraph 42 as a blessing over you. Now, beloved, may God our Father and Jesus Christ, the Son of God, His Son, and God the Holy Spirit, our triune God, bless you and keep you in this study, and may He bring great fruit in and through you for His glory. Amen and amen. Now, we move into your notes, coro. We move into your notes under the section, what are the parables of Jesus, the parables defined. So again, rather than just jump right into the parables, we want to look at the bird's eye view of the parables. What are they? So at the outset, we must first ask, what are parables? Why did Jesus teach in so many parables? Again, a good estimate is up to a third of all of His teaching was done in parables. Can we accurately interpret His parables? Can we? And if so, how? How are we to apply the parables to our lives? How do we teach the parables? These are the questions that my teaching is going to examine. Actually, these notes are going to be turned into a book one day, hopefully soon, and you'll have that book as a special gift from me. That leads me to paragraph number one under this section. Because Jesus teaches in the parable of the sower that its understanding is the key to understanding all of the parables, we begin our study with this parable. A parable so significant that all three of the synoptic gospels record this teaching. All three of them do. Let's look in Mark chapter 4 and verse 13. We're not getting into that parable just yet. Again, please be patient. The time is going to come when we're done with all the introductory notes, we're done with all the technical stuff, and we are going to get in depth into the Word of God. Believe me, I'd rather get into the Word now than to go through all the preliminaries, but the preliminaries are important. Thank you for your patience. Mark chapter 4 and verse 13. Mark 4 and verse 13. Jesus said to them, "Do you not understand this parable? How will you understand all of the parables?" And that's why we're going to focus on the parable of the sower in depth, very in depth. Now, paragraph 2 in your notes, after Matthew's account of the parable of the sower, which is in Matthew 13, Jesus goes on in that same chapter in Matthew 13 to give 6 more parables for a total of 7. And some even compare or consider verse 52 to be an 8th parable. It's at this point in Matthew's gospel, midway, that in paragraph number 3 of your notes, if you look in paragraph number 3 of your notes, it's at this point in his gospel, Matthew's gospel, midway through the ministry of Jesus, that Matthew begins to give a substantial amount of Jesus' parables. Why? There's a historical reason. There's a cultural context to it. Therefore, it is vital for us to examine several introductory comments about this parable. That leads me to paragraph number 4, Robert Gundry. In his commentary on Matthew, he notes that Matthew has 7 parables in chapter 13, and that the parable of the sower, the first one in that chapter, is really a parable about parables and their interpretation. We'll explain that more when we get further in. Paragraph number 5 in your notes. This insight is a valuable one to keep in mind throughout Matthew 13. And here's the first definition. A parable is literally a laying alongside for the purpose of comparison. That's what a parable is. A superb example of this will be seen when we get to the parable of the prodigal son in Luke 15, for example. Paragraph number 6. A parable can also serve as an illustration for Jesus to make a deeper point. We all understand that. If we're preachers and teachers of the Word, we use illustrations to help explain the Word of God better. Even if you're not a preacher and teacher of the Word, you use illustrations all the time. You say, well, it's like this. Well, let me give you an example. Well, let me tell you this story, right? That's what Jesus does. But that's not the only reason for a parable. Paragraph 7. However, while it is true that a parable can serve as an illustration, another commentator, Robert Stein, correctly warns that not all parables are necessarily self-evident illustrations. They're not. Paragraph 8. Indeed, if all of Jesus' parabolic illustrations were self-evident, then all of his listeners would immediately have understood them, right? Nevertheless, Jesus still used illustrations in his parables, and he taught parables as illustrations. I know this might sound confusing to you. Don't worry about it. It takes time to learn these things. I'll go over them and over them and over them, and you've got the notes, and you can talk with each other about these things as well. Again, loved ones, just be patient and depend upon the Holy Spirit. Now, paragraph number 9, Jesus taught those parables. He often taught parables in order to hide God's truths from the casual seeker or observer, while his intent was to reveal those truths to those who were hungry enough for God to ask for their interpretation and obey its message. For example, in Mark's account of the parable of the sower, Jesus gives the parable, and we read it in Mark chapter 1 through 9. But there's a change now, a pivot in verse 10. Mark tells us, as soon as he was alone, his followers, along with the 12, began asking him about the parables. Now, there's a significant contrast between verse 10 that I just read and verse 1 of Mark chapter 4. Read verse 1 with me now in Mark chapter 4. Mark tells us he began to teach again by the sea. Now watch this. And such a very large crowd gathered to him that he got into a boat in the sea and sat down, and the whole crowd was by the sea on the land. Notice verse 2. And he was teaching them many things in parables. Many things in parables. Again, notice that he is teaching to a, what does he say? A very large crowd. He finishes the parables, or he finishes the parable of the sower, but where are the large crowds? They don't come to him for understanding. Only his followers and his disciples come. So if the crowds are not hungry enough to understand the depth of the parable, and Jesus wasn't the only one to teach in parables, the rabbis taught in parables as well. The crowds knew. Now I'm talking about the historical context. The crowds of people knew that a parable was given to hide God's truths from the casual observer and to whet their appetite to come and ask for more. They already knew that. You see, when you understand the historical context of the parables and the cultural context, now when we read the parable, now it takes on a whole new meaning, right? Major contrast, principles of Bible study, between large crowds and his followers and the 12. All right. Now, Coro, let's go on to paragraph number... that was paragraph number 9, to hide God's truths. And paragraph 10, let us keep in mind how seriously God takes his word, and that Jesus even told his disciples not to cast your pearls before swine, because otherwise the swine will just trample them up. The pigs don't recognize the value of pearls, right? They're just little rocks to pigs. And so there are some people, there are many people who really don't care much about the Word of God. There's nothing we can do for them. Paragraph 11, it's important to recognize, as Robert Mounts correctly notes, that a parable, watch this, is a simple story taken from daily life that illustrates an ethical or a religious truth. Almost all the parables of Jesus are taken out of everyday life. They're not just made up stories. They're taken out of everyday life that people understood. Paragraph 12. Jesus' first two parables in Luke 15 are stories taken from daily life in Israel. And they're used specifically to teach the scribes and the Pharisees quite a number of things. Again, we also find this to be the case in Luke's first parable, the Good Samaritan. Jesus gives a story from everyday life to answer the lawyer's question in verse 29, but the main purpose of the parable deals with eternal life, not with helping your neighbor. Now, that might shock you. That might shock you. I would say that if you asked 100 Christians, what is the parable of the Good Samaritan all about? I bet you that 99 of them would say it's about how to be a better neighbor. Right? You probably thought that as well. But when you examine the text, and you go over it and over it and over it, and you've been faithful to develop the spiritual discipline of principles of Bible study, the reality of the parable that it deals with eternal life just jumps up at us. Remember, it begins with the lawyer seeking to justify himself, testing Jesus, and saying, what must I do? What must I do to inherit eternal life? That's what the focus of the parable is. Then Jesus gives a challenging parable to hide God's truths from this lawyer and test him. It's interesting, the lawyer was testing Jesus. Jesus tests the lawyer with the parable to see how badly that lawyer, how sincere he was, and how badly he really wanted to understand eternal life. The story has many important components into it, but it's a setup to challenge that lawyer to realize that none of his good works will ever get him into heaven, and not his Jewishness, not his understanding of the Word of God, none of that will get him into heaven. Only faith and trust in God for his salvation will get him in heaven. Of course, we'll get into that when we get into the parable of the Good Samaritan. But I just want to show you some of the challenges right at the beginning. Paragraph 14, however, the story illustrates the great error in understanding among the Jews at the time, historical context, of how one comes to eternal life. What was the historical context of the Jewish religious leaders at the time? They believed that because they were Jewish, they would spend eternity in heaven. They believed that by doing good works, they would spend eternity in heaven. And that's why most of what Jesus teaches is to show the error that you can never get to heaven based on your good works. It's only an offer of grace. Paragraph 15, hence, Jesus first has to show this lawyer his own self-righteous hypocrisy. He has to show him that he was not even able to keep God's law at all. Verses 31 through 37. And thus he needed Jesus as his Savior. The parable as an illustration could not be better or more effective. Paragraph 16, Mounts also informs us that Jesus, as I mentioned earlier, was not the only teacher in Israel who taught in parables. The rabbis used those parables for the same purposes that our Lord did, to hide God's truths from the casual observer and to explain them to their followers, to those who really wanted to know them. All right, we pick up now in paragraph number 17 in our study. Alfred Edersheim believes that the Jewish parables focused much more on earthly things and on devotion to the Torah. The Torah is the teaching or the instruction of the Lord, and specifically Genesis through Deuteronomy. Jewish parables focused much more on earthly things and on devotion to the Torah or the Word of God for merit before God, that is to earn favor with God, whereas Jesus' focus was on heavenly matters. It's for that reason that I'm going to shortly get into explaining the kingdom of God. Do you understand what the kingdom of God is all about? Because the parables focus extensively on the kingdom of God. So we're going to define the kingdom of God and explain it. Paragraph 18, for example, in the parable of the lost coin, an almost identical Jewish parable indeed called for more rigorous study of and devotion to the Torah instead of wasting one's time on a temporal matter such as a lost coin. On the other hand, a careful study of Jesus' teaching of this same parable will show that it deals with eternal life, and that Jesus came even for the most defiled sinners, while the Pharisees, the religious leaders of Israel, rejected those sinners. Paragraph 20, consequently, when we read some of Jesus' parables and try to take in some very strong words, it will be much easier to understand them in light of the historical and cultural context, people were used to hearing teaching on parables, though nothing quite like Jesus' parables. Paragraph number 21 in your notes, a strong caution must be given in interpreting the parables in an allegorical manner. I know I've mentioned that before, but I want to mention it again. An allegorical manner is finding a hidden meaning in each detail of a given parable. It is so tempting to think that every detail has a hidden meaning. It does not. Remember that what Jesus gives are stories from everyday life. The original hearers would not have thought, oh, well, that seed has a hidden meaning. Oh, the sower has a hidden meaning. Oh, the soil has a hidden meaning. Or in the parable of the Good Samaritan, going down to Jerusalem has a hidden meaning. The donkey has a hidden meaning. The inn has a hidden meaning. The Levite has a hidden meaning. The priest, it doesn't. This, as we when we get into it, it's just a normal aspect of Jewish life that Jesus is using for comparison. Parables are not allegories. Let me say it again. Parables are not allegories. Let me say it one more time. Parables are not allegories. All right. Paragraph number 22. Only allegories are allegories. To confuse parables with allegories will yield an incorrect interpretation of parables, which again are stories, illustrations, and comparisons. And all of the details of the parables serve only to highlight usually one or at the most two main points. So to interpret parables is easier than we might think. We confuse interpreting parables if we're looking for hidden meanings in every one of the details. Now, loved ones, you see why I'm taking so much time to go into technical detail. Do you see why I'm taking so much time to talk about the three principles of interpreting Scripture? What are they? What are those three principles of interpreting Scripture? I hope you're all talking amongst each other. What are the three principles of interpreting Scripture? Historical context, cultural context, and literary context. Let me go to paragraph number 23. Another commentator writes, a good general rule of interpretation is to remember that a parable is normally designed to convey one central truth only. We should therefore not try to find a spiritual meaning in every fine point, recognizing that some details are only the background of the parable. Otherwise, it would become an allegory, not a parable. And an allegory has little place in the New Testament and none at all in the teaching of Jesus. Well, I hope with my strong exhortation by now that you have the fear of God in you, as I have the fear of God in me, to look for the one or two at the most central points of the parable and not try to find hidden meanings in those parables. That was not the intent of Jesus. That's not how the original hearers would have understood parables either. And that's not how Scripture itself interprets them. Paragraph number 24. Although each parable has to do with Jesus' explanation and description of the kingdom of God, we'll see that their theme concerns how people respond to the offer of the kingdom that he... Paragraph 25, incidentally, Matthew, a Jew, uses the typical Jewish phrase, kingdom of heaven, instead of the phrase the kingdom of God. Why? Paragraph 26, this is because Jews at the time refused to utter the name of God, Yahweh, in order to avoid the potential of the improper use of his name and thus be guilty of what they unreasonably feared would be blasphemy. Paragraph 27, but Matthew also may be using kingdom of heaven to avoid the misunderstanding among the Jews that the kingdom in this age, paragraph 27, would be material, physical, and natural instead of a spiritual kingdom. If you'll look with me in Matthew chapter 4 and verse 17. Matthew 4 and verse 17. So for example, Jesus says from that, Matthew tells us, from that time Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. To repent is a spiritual matter, and the implication is, in order to get into the kingdom of heaven, you have to repent. Jesus makes that very clear when he speaks to Nicodemus in John chapter 3. And then if you'll turn with me to Matthew chapter 6 and verse 10. Matthew 6 and verse 10. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. The kingdom of heaven invades earth to accomplish what God wants in the earthly realm. But notice that this is in the context of prayer. Jesus is not calling for God to destroy the Romans at that point. It's a spiritual kingdom. Notice in John chapter 18. Turn with me to John 18. John 18 and verse 36. John 18 and verse 36. You all know this verse. Jesus answered, remember he's speaking to Pilate, and he said, my kingdom is not of this world. Watch this. If my kingdom were of this world, then my servants would be fighting so that I would not be handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not of this realm. He repeats it three times for emphasis, right? Principles of Bible study, when you see repetition, then you know that the writer is really trying to emphasize something. Turn with me over to Acts chapter 1 and verse 6. Acts chapter 1. Now we're getting into the Word of God more. Now I'm getting excited. Acts chapter 1 and verse 6. So when they had come together, they were asking him, saying, Lord, is it at this time that you are restoring the kingdom to Israel? They are expecting the prophecies of the prophets to be fulfilled in Jesus, and Israel will vanquish the Romans and rule the world. That's going to happen, but that's not the time. And so Jesus said to them in verse 7, it's not for you to know the times or the epochs which the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power. But this is spiritual power. When the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses, the preaching of the word, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria, and even to the remotest part of the earth. It's a spiritual kingdom. The remotest part of the earth. I'm living in the remotest part of the earth compared to Israel in San Jose, California, and in Siaya, Kenya. You're living in the remotest part of the world, although you're a lot closer to Jerusalem than I am. And then turn with me to Romans chapter 14 and verse 17. Romans chapter 14 and verse 17. You all know this verse as well. For the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. It's not material. But righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Paragraph number 28 of your notes, Warren Wiersbe also gives us important insight into the purpose for our Lord's parables at this point in his ministry, midway through his 3.5 years. There was growing opposition against him from Israel's religious leaders, and the time for his crucifixion was fast approaching. Paragraph 29. Thus, at this period of his ministry, he had to teach his disciples that he would be crucified, something they had great difficulty understanding and accepting, since they were expecting an earthly kingdom, a political, military Messiah. Paragraph 30, the Jews at this time expected their Messiah to defeat Israel's enemies, at the time Rome, and cause Israel to rule the world with the disciples as Jesus' leaders. This will happen, and there are the references that I give you in your notes in paragraph 30, but not until his return. Paragraph 31, accordingly, the parables would serve to answer the natural questions the disciples would inevitably have, but would not understand until after his resurrection. If the king were to be crucified, what would happen to his kingdom? So in our next discussion, we will define the kingdom of God because it is so prominent in Jesus' parables and indeed in all of his teaching. We're getting close, loved ones. Be patient with me again. We're getting close to getting in Mark chapter 4. But first we need to get into the kingdom of God and then we'll be in there. So please, thank you for your patience. And I need to stop here.